Hello and welcome to WeLearn, Virtual Learning Network. This is session number 11 of Modern Indian Political Thought and the chapter is Colonialism, Caste, Order and Tribal Movements. Let's see the topics to be covered. Introduction, Colonialism and its impact in the cultural and social fields, Reformist Movements, Colonialism and its impact on the economy, Caste, Order and Colonialism and Tribal Movements. Let's see the introduction. The advent of British colonialism drastically and rapidly altered the social and economic structure of India and of course alongside its politics and administrative setup. So with the coming of British colonialism, it changed rapidly the social, economic, political structure of India and alongside it also changed and it also overhauled its administrative and political setup. In fact, the changes in the polity and administration, namely the constitution of India as a single politico-administrative entity, creation of a civil service, an army, a judiciary, etc., were necessary to effect widespread changes in the socio-economic structure of the country. So these changes, socio-politico-administrative entity, a civil service, a judiciary, army, they were necessary to effect widespread changes in the socio-economic structure. So all these things were important. The creation of army, the creation of a judiciary, executive, legislature, these arms of the government were necessary for creating socio-economic changes and to create changes in the socio-economic structure of the country. And it was also required to have a written constitution as a single political administrative entity where every rule, regulation about rights, fundamental rights and duties, everything was written in that, to which people can refer, and also rights, equal rights and liberties should be given to the citizens of the country. Colonialism and its impact in the cultural and social fields. The integration of Indian economy with the world capitalist system was followed by changes in the social and cultural fields. Colonialism facilitated India's contact with the momentous changes that the Western world was undergoing and introduced Indian intellectuals to the radical and liberal ideas of democracy, popular sovereignty and rationalism. With the coming of colonialism, India's contact with the Western world also was introduced, and the intellectuals were also introduced to the liberal ideals of democracy, of sovereignty, rationalism, changes, liberty, dignity, equality. All these principles, all these elements were introduced to the Indian intellectuals and they were highly influenced by it, and the contact with the other Western world, the contact with the Western powers was increased. The socio-cultural milieu of pre-colonial India was primarily shaped by the family and kinship institutions which conditioned the mind with the religious and caste identity. So in the pre-colonial setup, in the pre-colonial India, it was basically family, kinship, the caste system, and these institutions were dominating the religious and the social identity of the people. It was not democracy, it was not rationalism, it was not sovereignty, it was not population which were influencing the pre-colonial India, but it was shaped by family and kinship institutions. So, and caste system. So the caste system, religious identity, family and kinship, they were dominating the pre-colonial India. But with the coming of colonialism, with the coming of British Empire, the Indian economy and the capitalist system was introduced by many changes, and they were introduced to the concepts of democracy where people were given the freedom to cast their own vote, and for also free speech to say whatever they want to without any fear of the authority, and also to be free from any external control, equality, to be free from to be equal in the eyes of law, and also to use reason and logic. Reformist movements. These movements took the form of a struggle against the backward elements of a traditional culture, an important dimension of which was opposition to caste. So this was basically a struggle against the orthodoxy, the struggle against the backwardness, the backward elements of the traditional culture, which only focused on orthodoxy and it did not emphasize the ideas of liberalism and democracy. And also the movements like Brahmo Samaj and Prarthana Samaj advocated the removal of caste distinction. The caste system was there, which divided the society, which divided the individuals also, wherein upper, lower and upper lower caste was there. The system of upper, lower and uppers and lower caste was introduced, and which actually divided the society, and it created a lot of distinctions among the society. Following the reform movements of the early 19th century, which were explicitly influenced by liberal ideas, there were religious reform movements like the Arya Samaj and Ramakrishna Mission. There were religious reform movements like Arya Samaj, Ramakrishna Mission, and also other reform movements introduced by many writers and many social thinkers at that time, which focused on upliftment, education and also equality, democracy, liberalism, on the equality and dignity of individuals. And these reformist movements was a struggle against the backward orthodox elements of the traditional culture, and it was an opposition to the caste system, which did not allow individuals to progress, to grow. Though different in their religious messages and concepts, these movements too had an anti-caste edge. So they too focused, they were too against the caste system, which divided the society as a whole. Anti-caste movements. Some details. One of the most important aspects of these reform movements was their opposition to caste and its accompanying rigidity. Their opposition to the caste system and its accompanying rigidity. The caste system was hugely rigid. The caste system was not free or liberal in character. It was highly rigid, and these movements focused to remove the rigidity and the caste system and free individuals from these superstitious practices. The outspokenly anti-caste movements led by Ramaswamy Naikar, Jyotiba Phule and Sri Narayan Guru bear testimony to this. As you shall see later in this blog, the chief inspiration for Ambedkar's crusade came from the ideals of liberty, fraternity and equality, the slogans of the Western revolutions only. So Ambedkar, when Ambedkar's crusade, Ambedkar's revolt, when it started, it only came from these ideals of being free, of being equal in the eyes of law, and also and these were the slogans of Western revolutions, of the Western movements only. The socially progressive stance of these movements on questions of sati, dowry, widow remarriage, etc., along with intense questioning of the rigidities of the caste system, show that Western ideas of the liberalism had a powerful impact. Though the Britishers who came, they also extracted, they also extensively used the resources of India, but their ideas of liberalism had a powerful impact on the Indians, and they focused on removing the evil and superstitious practices of that time, like sati, woman being burned on the pyre of her husband, dowry, widow remarriage. Also when the husband of a particular woman was died and they were not allowed to remarry, so widow remarriage, also these new legislations were being taken out, where these evil practices were finished, and also Western ideas of liberalism were highly appreciable. Colonialism and its impact on the economy. We shall deal primarily with the impact on the agrarian economy. Amongst the major changes introduced by the Britishers in Indian economy, the far-reaching changes in agriculture were probably the most important. There were a lot of changes in the agrarian economy as well. These changes introduced with a view to cornering the surplus in the form of land revenue and to make Indian agriculture an appendage of the British economy greatly transformed the face of the countryside. They were forced to pay very high rents and were made to pay illegal dues. So the agrarian economy was highly affected, was highly suffered due to the British policies and legislations, and land revenue was cornered by the landowners, and the British agriculture was made inferior to the British economy, and it also the various policies and legislations brought of the of paying very high rents, of paying very high taxes and dues to the Britishers by the Indian farmers, that actually killed the Indian agricultural sector, and they were forced to pay very high rents which were not affordable for them. Caste order and colonialism. G.S. Courier, in his authoritative work on caste, has enumerated six such features: segmental division of society, hierarchy or rigid ordering of society from top to bottom on the basis of ritual status. So G.S. Courier, is the authoritative work on caste, he has enumerated six features wherein society will be segmented, there would be a division of society, and there would be hierarchy, and there would be strict ordering of society from top to the bottom on the basis of the rituals and the status, social status, restrictions in interdining and social intercourse according to the detailed rules. There would be restrictions. The people from the different castes cannot dine, cannot sit together, they cannot have social interactions, they cannot eat together according to the rules. Civil and religious disabilities and privileges of different sections. So there would be disability for some people and there would be privileges for some people. Lack of unrestricted choice of occupation. So there would be also no choice of occupation, to what to choose and what not to do, what to do, whether in career wise, basically there would be no choice. Endogamy or restriction of marriage. There would be restriction of marriage on the people. Impact of British judicial and administrative practices. The judicial and administrative practices introduced by the British based on the principle of equality before law obviously made no distinction between castes. They made no distinction between castes. They did not have superstitions or religious practices. They advocated the principle of equality, that every citizen was equal before the rule of law. Further, introduction by the British of a uniform criminal law removed from the purview of caste many matters that used to be adjudicated by it earlier. No longer were caste governing bodies to decide on matters of assault, adultery and so on. Caste governing bodies and caste committees, they were not authorized now to decide on matters of assault, adultery or on other practices. The second aspect was the enactment of certain laws which practically eroded the authority of castes in many respects, though practically often the impact was marginal. And also to enact certain laws which practically eroded the authority of castes, which practically finished or removed the authority of castes in many respects, though politically, economically or socially, and to introduce these laws through which these authority of castes would be finished. And also the introduction by the British of a uniform criminal law wherein removed from the purview of caste, it would not be applicable to higher caste or a lower caste, but the uniform criminal law would be applicable to every caste in many matters which are to be adjudicated by it. Impact of economic changes. You have seen how this changing economic structure led to integration of certain nomadic people into the caste structure with expansion of agricultural activities. It also led to a change in the status of certain caste groups within the caste hierarchy, with land becoming a commodity that could be sold to anyone who could pay for it. Even a low caste member provided an opportunity to many to acquire an economic status whereby they could gradually strive for upward mobility. Wherein now it was in the change of anybody could buy the land provided he or she could pay for it, and land became a commodity that could be sold to anyone who could pay for it. Even a low caste member who had money, who had the power of money, could, or who had a good economic status, they could also take the land, they could also buy the land, give the money, and they could also strive for upward mobility or to improve their quality of life. And also certain nomadic people who used to roam from one place to another, they also were integrated into the agricultural activities and the caste structure as well. Anti-caste movements under the influence of liberal philosophy. The third major way in which the caste structure was affected was through powerful anti-caste and social reform movements under the Arya Samaj in northern India, Raja Ram Mohan Roy in Bengal, Jyotiba Phule in Maharashtra, Sri Narayan Guru in Kerala, Ramaswamy Naikar in Madras, and so on. So, and also, caste structure was also affected due to the anti-caste social reform movements by the various social and political thinkers in various parts of the country. The major themes taken up by these movements were reform in regard to the position of women, equality for oppressed castes, general reform in religion and rituals. To improve the position of women, for the upliftment of women, they were not given equality, and for also equality for suppressed and oppressed castes, they were not given the rights and proper equality which the upper caste people were given. And to have a general reform, to have a general overhaul in the religious practices and also the rituals. So for instance, social reformers had exerted enough pressure for the enactment of the Special Marriage Act in 1872 that made intercaste marriage possible. So also social reformers worked very hard for the enactment of the Special Marriage Act that could make the marriage between the intercaste possible. It was no longer considered a sin. Tribal movements. The tribal movements in colonial India, it must be understood, were born out of deep dissatisfaction and often discontent against socio-economic policies of the British government, which adversely affected their lives. And also it was a deep dissatisfaction and discontent. These movements were the result of the disappointment and dissatisfaction with the socio-economic policies of the British government, which the British government imposed upon them. And these policies adversely affected the lives of these people. And they were far, and the British government did not look after them properly. Whether it be the question of encroachment of tribal lands by money lenders backed by the government, the money lenders took the lands of the tribal people and they encroached upon their freedom and they encroached upon their land and also the property. The acquisition of tribal forest as well, they acquired their forest. They imposed high taxation or enhancement of rent. Every one of these policies created among the tribes and nomadic communities extreme distrust of the authorities and turned them against the rulers. These policies and these also laws, they made them distrust towards the government, and they also turned against the rulers, that is often against outsiders in general. So these policies of the British government, they made these tribal people against them, because it made them to pay high rent, and it also destroyed their social and economic fabric. So this was all about tribal movements and how they created how the policies and the legislations of the British government, they created distrust and disappointment amongst the tribal people, and how they fought for their independence as well, and was all about making changes and social and reform movements. That's all we have for you in this session. These are some of the questions. You have to do it yourself. Question number one, what was the impact of British colonialism in social and cultural fields, and what were the two chief ways in which colonialism affected the caste system? Thank you. Happy learning. We learning.